Yes, that way you know you give you a decent stipend whereby you'll be able to maintain yourself, but you cannot live a luxurious life. But we enough for you, we'll take care of you, you can participate. I wish many of you enroll for this program so that all of you are participants of this great program for the regeneration of motherland. I invite you all for that. And these few words, I say goodbye to you for the time being, but I'll be hoping to see many of you sooner than later. Thank you.
We feel honored to have with us Dr. G. Satish Reddy, presently scientific advisor to Raksha Mantri and Director General's Missiles and Strategic Systems. We look forward to be inspired by you, sir. The dais is all yours.
Very good morning. Swamiji, Sunilji, Tripathiji, Yaneshi, and all others who are present here. Very good morning. As number of speakers are there today and the way I had discussions with the organizers here, I confined myself to defense technologies and the growth where we stand and things like that. A lot of other people are there, like Raviji is there, Kakotkarji is also coming in the evening and things like that and all that. If you look at the general science and technology development in the country, I'm not going back to the era of 500 years back, 1000 years back and all that. Let's talk about the present context. After independence, I think we started in a very slow way. If you take the curve, has been very, like many of you science students who are there, like a diode, voltage versus current, when you take it, it was initially in the offset period for till almost 80s. We were trying to develop ourselves small things, small technologies, and somewhere more like nascent stage we were there and we were trying to develop. ISRO, Atomic Energy, and DRDO, these three are called the strategic departments of the country. They are called the strategic departments, doing the most critical and important work for the national security and the related aspects of it, which actually have connectivity with the critical departments of the country also. If you look at it, they're all started in the late 50s, somewhere around that, or early 60s, and started showing their presence somewhere around in the 70s. Presence has been felt. If you look at the three departments, there are three visionaries who have laid the roadmap for these three departments. For the atomic energy, it is Dr. Homi J. Bhabha, who was the visionary, who laid the roadmap, who thought what it should be and then laid the roadmap. For the Department of Space, it is Professor Satish Dhawan, who actually visualized what will be the space in future. In fact, let us imagine, sometimes what happens is, if we talk something today, what is going to happen after 40 years or so, we will never be able to imagine that we think he is talking something nonsense. Same thing happened when Professor Satish Dhawan said, when space is going to be dominating the human lives and society this way, people never believed it. They thought he is telling something, he is heading or he is a leading scientist or something like that. But today you know that what is the space today, space traffic you have to see, and I don't know, somebody else will be able to talk or I'll try to touch upon that. So, enormous applications. Everything in our life is connected to the space today. So the space has dominated the society this way, and that is what he has visualized at that time and laid the roadmap. And similarly, when you come to the defense, little late, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, he is the one who laid the roadmap for the future course of defense technologies also. So when you look at the three departments, atomic energy, today, after our nuclear explosion tests, whatever we have done, are both tests. Today, the power plants, what we have in the country, and number of power plants. And the roadmap, when you look at it, by about 2030, the amount of power what they are going to generate for the country. This is enormous work, and we have stabilized ourselves with the limited resources available in the country. I'll stop here about this department as Kapotkati is coming in the afternoon. Coming to the space, the first vehicle SLV-3, when it was launched, it was a failure. And the project director was Dr. Kalam. He was the project director. It was a failure. So that is where people try to learn things and learn. Actually, even now I say, when a mission fails for us, the inputs are enormous for us. When a success is there, inputs are very less, very few. So in a failure mission, you will learn a lot of things. So that is what has happened for Dr. Kalam also, and people learn that. So look at the space, Department of Space. From there, from SLV, they went into ASLV, then PSLV, then GSLV. Look at the history also, the reliability of the systems what are made. PSLV, the last mission was the 37th consecutive really successful launch. Consecutive, it's an important event we have to understand. 37 in a row have been successful, and many things have been done during these missions, including the 104 satellites what they have launched very recently, out of which 83 are from one country, and we only had about 3 satellites of our own. The same PSLV mission was used for Chandrayaan. In the Chandrayaan mission, it's one thing going and orbiting around the moon. Then the payloads what we have pulled are very important payloads in the satellite, which gave tremendous amount of data, which even the United States of America has taken a lot of data from our paper and used for many varieties of applications, like a hyperspectral payload and things like that, which are very, very useful at 100 kilometers altitude. A hyperspectral payload data is very important. Same way, had the Mars mission, again used the same PSLV vehicle, and very successful mission. You all know even the type of data what is coming and things like that. Then we also had attempted GSLV, the geostationary launch vehicle, which actually orbits at about 36,000 kilometers from the surface of Earth. This GSLV was looking for an engine called cryogenic engine, which gives you a liquid propulsion engine, which gives you higher thrust. That's the basic difference in that. And so we were trying to take it from Russia. Then people said that internationally, why do you give this technology to India and then things like that, and GSLV, whatever cryogenic engine technology will be used for missiles, and don't use it, don't give it, and all that, they'll stop. Many times, I will tell about this same point and later in the defense technologies also. When people don't give the technologies, it is always advantageous to us. If you give, we don't try to learn. We try to copy it and try to take it and all that, and technologies and basic knowledge won't have. So because the cryogenic engine was not given, our people had to work on it. We had to develop our own cryogenic engine. And the cryogenic engine was developed. And that is what is flying in our GSLV now today. Our own cryogenic engine flying in our GSLV, keeping our satellites at 36,000 kilometers orbits. Then, as I said, Chandrayaan, Mars mission and all that over. Also, to re-enter into the atmosphere and capture the vehicle back, to see that it's a space mission to have, they have also done experiments where they could capture the vehicle back during the re-entry phase, using some of the parachutes which are developed by DRDO. So many things. They're trying to have a space station also, a lot of other technologies. They're trying to have a payload of about 4,000 kgs, is another important thing. A lot of such important achievements have been done in the space department. Coming to from there to the Ministry of Defense. As I said, in the 80s, the presence of DRDO is not felt. It's only that you started some of the laboratories and started working on it, and the results were yet to come. you are more in the scientific research mode than coming to the products and development innovation mode. 1980s, Dr. Kalam came to DRDO as director of a missile laboratory, and then later he became the scientific advisor and things like that. Look at when we talk about Dr. Kalam when he came, 1983, we didn't have a single missile of our own. Everything was imported. We didn't have a single missile. Or you talk about further later to it, we didn't have an aircraft, we didn't have a tank, we didn't have a radar, we didn't have a torpedo, we didn't have a electronic warfare system or many things, you talk about it. We didn't have anything. So the first missile, actually you have to understand a little bit, let me tell about Dr. Kalam also here. We have to understand one thing. He used to tell, and he keeps, wherever he went there, he kept on giving a talk and saying that, you should always think big, this is one thing. You should not think small. Generally, when you don't have a single missile if you are not developed, somebody would have said, give me one missile project, I'll try to develop a missile and try to testify it and see what happens, and then I take up one more. But you see the guts of the person. He went to the government with at one go five missiles I'll develop. Integrated guided missile development program, asking for a huge money. And first of all, you should have the courage to go to the government and ask for, when you don't have a single fellow, I'll develop five. So he went there and could convince the then the Prime Minister Srimati Indira Gandhi and could get five projects sanctioned at one go, Urujivi, Agni, Akash, Trishul, Nag, all the projects. And the government had confidence in him. That is also one more important. The government also has to put confidence in the scientists, the scientific community, and then give it. And sanctioned all the five projects. I was lucky enough to be in the initial program of that initial development also. 1988 was the first Prithvi which was successfully testified from Sriharikota. In fact, there was no range also. Sriharikota was the ISRO space launch vehicles launch pad, and from there we went and kept. I remember that day actually when Prithvi was taken and kept on the launch pad, the missile, people said the success is 75%. Meaning India could make a missile and come to the launch pad and keep it vertical also, and then you are ready to fire also. See, this much you could do. So that itself was people saying 75%. And the very first mission was successful. And very next year, 1989, Agni re-entry vehicle, going out of atmosphere and coming back. The basic difference why Agni name is given also is that when you go out of atmosphere and come back, you come with tremendous velocity. It depends on today, if you take about Agni 5, Agni 5 comes back with about 6 kilometers per second or so velocity. So with that velocity, when you enter into the atmosphere, out of the atmosphere friction, what you have, the density of atmosphere creates a friction, you get into a deceleration of Agni 5, let's say deceleration of 90 g, 900 meters per second square is the deceleration. So the temperatures on the various parts of the body, anything can be 600 to 3200, 3300 degrees centigrade. So that is the type of temperature. But the whole electronics and everything inside should be working at the time. That means the temperature inside you require at about less than 50. So that is why you need a heat shield. So that is why when Agni is coming, it comes like an Agni ball of Agni, Agni gold. I said yes, I got. So that is why the name Agni is also given. See, you took it, you could show its success. And in fact, let me tell you, Prithvi was launched from Sriharikota, but Agni decision was taken, we will have our own range and we will do it from our own range. That is in ITR Balasore, Baleshwar, in Orissa district, Orissa state of our eastern part of it. And it is launched from there. And when we went there, actually, let me tell you, Agni did not take off for twice. The third time only took off, actually. The scenario was so new that you were not knowing how to control other things also in the range. A lot of things, out of confusion, first launch did not take place. Mere out of confusion. So that is the type of a situation. You had your own range you have created and gone. And at the same time, in the year 1988, immediately during the Bhujwala, the RCI, the biggest laboratory of the country, constructed, saying that Kalam wanted to have a NASA sort of a laboratory in the country, and RCI was constructed. And about 50 to 60% of the people from DRDL were moved to RCI. See, imagine, when major launches of Prithvi, Agni, Akash are going on, Trishul are going on, then you have constructed another lab, moving all the people there, moving the infrastructure there, there's a work disturbance, then you have constructed a range there, and then you are trying to launch Agni there. So many activities. How it was taken, you have to imagine. How people were motivated to do that. In fact, I'll tell you, during that 88-89 period, I think I'm one of those 200-300 scientists who every day for that 1 year went home after night 2 o'clock and again come back in the morning. So such a type of an emotion or commitment was created and people have worked, and that's how that all the things in all those new environment also things went on there. So that is how today we look at it. Many missiles have come. One Prithvi has created Prithvi 1, Prithvi 2 and Dhanush. One Agni what has been launched that day. Today Agni 1, Agni 2, Agni 3, Agni 4, Agni 5. The Akash missile which was taken up that day. Today in the country we have more than 20,000 crores orders on for Akash missile on video. Today. In fact, when the Agni was launched, and around the same time, roughly, within the next about 2 to 3 years, we had again Pokhran nuclear test also, Agni test. This again made the countries in the western side, saying that India is growing, India is learning, India is doing, let's stop everything. Almost all technologies were stopped to us. Rather, I don't say technologies, all the components, all the systems what were coming also were stopped. Again, as I said in the ISRO side sometime back, we should thank them that they have stopped them. Because they have stopped, today you have made completely all of them indigenous. I can very confidently tell you, having come from missiles, more than 90% of the systems components which are used in the missiles are indigenous today. More than 90%. Only that you don't have foundry in the country, so electronic chips and all that you have import, all those aspects are separate. So that is the situation. In fact, I'll tell you other way around. When we started that Prithvi and Agni, there were not more than about 5 or 6 industries working with us, maybe 7 or 8 industries. Even a nut, bolt, fastener also, we were trying to make ourselves in the laboratory. And today, I think 2.5 years back, I called industry partners meet in Hyderabad. 700 people attended. And today, in the 20,500 crores orders what BDL has got for the Akash, 83% of this Akash missile items are coming from industry, private industry. So BDL has assumed the role of a lead integrator. He is not anymore manufacturer, he is called an integrator. So that is the type of ecosystem which has been developed in the country, and you have got that. And from there onwards, talk about any missile today, you have Akash, you have Agni, you have Astra, you have Nag, you have Helena, then you have underwater missiles you have developed, and many other, any type of a missile has been developed, many varieties have come, including the only supersonic missile which is available in the world, BrahMos. It is the only supersonic missile. This is also a dream of Dr. Kalam. You used to say whenever we were making a missile successful launch, so it used to be that you were joining a club of 6 nations, 5 nations, 7 nations and all. And from there, you used to say, funny guys, you are making every time I am joining 7 nations, 6 nations, 5 nations when I am going to the first one. So the BrahMos is the one with Indo-Russia joint venture using the 2 names in the 2 countries, Brahmaputra here and Moskva River. And combining these two and bringing the name synonym to our Brahmastra, BrahMos has been created. It's even today, that's the only supersonic cruise missile in the world. That's how we have the best missile in the world, sort of a thing, or no one else has got a sort of a missile is there. So, likewise, many things. Today, I can confidently say any missile, whatever they want, almost most of the varieties of missiles what world has got, almost all we have today. Almost all we have. Otherwise, any services, anything they want also, we should be able to develop in 4 to 5 years. That is the confidence we have got today. the government is also saying we should have a complete self-reliance in missiles in next 5 years. From there onwards, the Kalam or other people that time, they wanted to have our own aircraft. Why we should buy the aircraft? The LCA program is initiated. Tejas. Yeah, good. So people say, let me tell you a little bit about that. Keep on criticizing ourselves. See, in a scenario you are able to come out and do something. Yeah, Tejas has taken 25 years. Let me give you the example. Today the Indian Air Force is buying the Rafale aircraft. Rafale aircraft is from Europe. They had the capability, they had the designs, they had the ecosystem by that time, available everything. Rafale aircraft is taken 18 years. From the day you wanted to design it to the certification. So if that country where they had the ecosystem, industry, design capability, everything, for me, let me tell you one thing. When Tejas aircraft was to be made, then we thought these people, including the armed forces, please don't hold me if I don't think media is there here, we were not knowing how to lay the specifications of the aircraft. I want this aircraft, you were not able to make the specifications. You were such a condition, and 25 years if you take, and that fellow takes 18 years, is it that we are so bad we have to criticize ourselves every day? Today, Adu Praha, last year when he has flown, and this year also Dhanova, Air Chief, has flown, the LCA, they were saying that this is one of the best aircraft I have flown. There is no doubt about it. Yes, we must not have indigenized everything in that and all that, that is a great issue. We have become one of the 6 nations in the world who have such technologies, who have made that light combat aircraft. And you have made your own Arjun tank. You are one of the 6 nations in the world, again, who made an Arjun tank. Today, we can make any radar what country needs. We have already made most of the radars which are there now with all these missiles and other systems are our own radars, including Akash. Lot of people from the world are asking how you supply as Akash, you supply as this, that and all. So radars you have mastered. Electronic warfare, the complete electronic warfare systems are being made here in the country today. Torpedoes. You have made torpedoes, you are successful, and then world is again asking for Varunastra and all the torpedoes today. And then you have built your own nuclear submarine yourself. See, from Arihant. From nowhere, you could build your own Arihant. And so you could build your own missiles which can take off from underwater from submarine also. So many technologies over the last about 20-25 years have been developed, and you have become one of the 5 nations, 6 nations. See, this is where I keep talking about academic institutes. Academic institutes today, we want all of us here think and the entire nation thinks I should be number 1, number 2 in these technologies, I should make a weapon nobody else should have and all that. But then how it comes? It is a science and technology. I should have a core research. Basic research should be there. And if I don't have one academic institute standing in the first 100 of the world rankings, and my best institutes which are there supposed to be IITs in the technology side, and 90-95% of them go out abroad, and you have to work with the remaining people, and you don't have one in the first 100, and with these people you should make the first in the world. How is it possible? You need to have a complete ecosystem. Need to have academic institutes. Academic institutes should do the basic research. Basic technology should come from the academic institutes. R&D institutes should work more on the development or applied research, or you should work on the translational research. And then industry produces it. This is what is required. The opportunities are around us. But then definitely I could see a sea change in the youngsters today, the people who are coming out of the colleges, showing lot of interest, lot of capabilities also. See, what happened is, when we were coming, we had to learn everything from scratch ourselves. Probably the today's generation, many things are available to them. So some basics have been created. So people are coming with brilliant ideas. Students are, many students, in fact, every day as a scientific advisor, I keep getting lot of ideas coming from various people. Youngsters are coming. Every day when I visit, the core technologies, youngsters are coming up and establishing their own units. Other day I went to Pune, I visited about 4 or 5. Particularly one industry when I visited, they started working on a core subject called navigation. And there are, I think, 45 or 47 people. The average age of them is 25. 25. I was thinking, I told them also, I'm feeling like I have come to a college. There are people who are working. One boy who came from Coimbatore, he came to me saying that he will develop some UAV, a special UAV. I gave him a project. Then he came out with some specific propulsion for interplanetary motion, like Mars mission, whatever you are using and all that. The boy actually burnt his hand also working on this propulsion and all those things from Coimbatore. I have connected him to Kiran Kumar, the chairman of ISRO. And he was so impressed with that, yes, it is a good work, and why not we pursue? He gave that young boy who just passed his final year 2 crores worth of a project. So people are coming out with many, many ideas. I am giving you only one example. There are many things what we can do today. We need to have innovation. We need to work on this with our own innovation. See, our own website, DRDO, MOD website, we have put lots of products which are to be indigenized today, what we are importing today. So people can come out with ideas and work on that. We are ready to work with many academic institutes to do many projects on innovation, many other things, related things which are related to different stuff. We can fund you and the idea can be converted into actually a product. This is one of the schemes called Innovative Research Initiative. Then there is something called Technology Development Fund. You do a small startup or something like that, you have a company and you want to develop something, you have a design available, but you need funding for developing that, or you need funding for infrastructure, this technology development funding will be there. So many initiatives. In fact, country needs a lot in futuristic areas. One of the futuristic areas I want to tell you is manufacturing. A country, unless it develops itself in manufacturing, in fact, as a scientific advisor, I have taken 4 subjects. These 4 subjects are very, very important. One is materials. We need to work a lot on the materials for the country. Unless we become yourself rich in materials, we can never dominate the world. That is what China is doing today. In fact, trying to kill every other industry available in various countries, including India, by lowering the prices. Second one is manufacturing. Manufacturing is a very, very important thing. In fact, Obama has appointed one advisor for manufacturing. And fortunately, let me tell you, he is again in India. He is a professor, Sridhar Kota. He is from a professor from Michigan University. And they are trying to establish 42 innovative manufacturing institutes in various fields, including foldable electronics, or materials, or additive manufacturing, or textiles, or shipping, whatnot in those areas. Come out with innovative manufacturing technology, which reduces the cost, which increases the productivity. This is another very important thing where productivity has to be improved through better manufacturing techniques. This is another thing. A third most important thing for most of you youngsters is cyberspace, cyber security products, or cyber related products. Today, country needs them like anything. My feeling is at least 5 to 10,000 people have to work on that. We cannot be dominated by somebody else in the cyber area and we cannot be the receiving ends. We should be aggressive. We have to develop cyber products. Cyber defense products, cyber offense products, cyber laying, cyber test products, whatnot. There is a model called Unit 8200 in Israel. Unit 8200 is either people, students who are in the colleges or just who comes out. They are the people who works on the cyber and the government funds them. They develop the products and give. More than 5 to 10,000 students are just passed out people with various small units. So many of you can have in a small industry while working in a college also, while studying in a college also, while doing a research in a college also, an institute, and come out with this. This is one area where country needs a lot of work needs to be done, but in a short span, in the next 2 to 3 years, we need to work on that. As a whole, country is again concentrating on that enormously. One thing we cannot lack. And one more area is space for defense applications. We have been good space for civilian applications, space for defense applications. So number of opportunities, tremendous technologies. See, in India, unfortunately, we have been technology follower. We can never be a successful people if we are followers. We have to lead, or we have to be at least on par with them. What happens is, a technology comes from somewhere in USA or Europe or somewhere, or Japan. We look at it, we try to buy it, and we look at it, and after about 10 years, 15 years, we try to indigenize it. Meaning, a technology which comes there, we are trying to make it after 15 years. You can never shine yourself with this. If you want to sell your product, you have to be a contemporary one, you have to be a state-of-the-art product, or first of its kind in the world product. Then only you will be able to sell. If the country has to become rich today, I don't think all of you come and make industries or make products and supply to our own armed forces and the country becomes rich. We are only avoiding buying from outside. That is all what we can do. What we need to do is we have to sell all over the world. Our product should go to every country. That is how we will be able to earn money, or earn funds, earn revenue, earn foreign exchange, and make the country prosperous. So we need to come out with innovative technologies. See the contribution of Indians in the ICT area, information communication technology area, whether we have established our own industries which were supplying this or not, that is a separate issue. But we have contributed enormously for each and every innovation product which has come today in the world today in the ICT area. I think Indians would have contributed more than 60-70% of the products which are available in the ICT area, whether software or hardware. If we could do that much in that ICT area, why not we do in all other areas like defense or many other technologies? And that is the only way country can progress today. A world in any country today has to progress is out of technology today. I'm talking about financially progressing the country. I'm talking about culture, spiritualism, our own character and all that Swamiji has already said. I'm talking about technology. You take the example of Finland. After Russian countries have fallen down so much, economy has fallen so bad, the country didn't know what to do. The chief of the country has asked for a competition, come out with a big idea and see so. What is the idea come out? How do I take back this country again to prosperity? Some students came out, I think young students, or just passed out students, and given the idea. That is how the Nokia phone has come. Sold all over the world. Country was back in its economic growth. This is one example. How Japan has come today, how Israel has come today, purely out of technologies. So we have to use our technological brains, come out with innovative ideas, and make the country prosper here. Opportunities are plenty. Government is encouraging a lot. Enormous amount of features have been created to support this. I wish all of you will use that, come out with better ideas, and work for the country and make the country prosper. Thank you very much.
Swamiji, and